Hi, welcome to part 4 of my review featuring SLA Industries 2nd edition, the core rulebook. In this part of the review, we are going to see specific details concerning travel and transportation, and the worlds within the world of progress. If you haven't seen the other parts of this review, please check out the link in the description below. It's going to take you to the playlist of the review. So, when it comes to travel and transportation, travel throughout Mort City and other major cities comes in many guises, but walking is the most common. Public transport also features heavily, with elevators between levels, buses, trains, subways, and taxis all competing with personal vehicles for footfall. For long distances, atmospheric shuttles can get you from one side of the planet to the other in under a day. Let's talk about shift blocks. Shift blocks are platforms that move large groups of people up and down through inner downtown. They are basically huge elevators. Slow, smelly, and unreliable, they are constantly crowded by civilians willing to put up with being packed on a platform just to get from one level to the other. When it comes to buses, the bus system on Mort is lacking, with some sectors not even having one. You can't get from sector to sector on the buses as they are all tied to the local sector management system. When it comes to the subway, the underground train system of Mort City, this is the favored commuter system in the upper levels of downtown, but once the workforce is done with the confined trains, it becomes a haven for bored citizens. Subways don't go up or down, so you can't get a train from one layer to another. Most subway stations have a shift block installed. Next, we have gas trains. The quickest way to get around Mort, short of reality folding, is by gas train. With fewer stations than the subway and longer distances between them, these tubed trains are only convenient if both ends of your journey are near a station, or if you need to travel long distances or out of Mort City completely. Gas trains are tubular trains, powered by magnetic propulsion in soft vacuum tubes, that travel at speeds around 1000 km per hour at peak. The tubes run from Central Station to a few key locations around the city. There are approximately 100 or so active stations. When it comes to taxis, they are common above downtown, providing SLA employees a way to get around that doesn't require them to mix with undesirables. Now, about other details concerning personal transportation, you have cars, motorbikes, powered armor. There are many forms of transport that SLA Industries would like you to buy. The road system, when it's working, allows easy access across Mort City, with gentle ramps between the layers and plenty of roads to get anywhere you want. Now, when it comes to the world of progress itself, concerning the flow of people and activities within it, this is a catch-all term for the entirety of SLA-held and owned space. It is not a singular world, as its name suggests, but a galaxy, housing numerous solar systems with planets which in various ways serve the company. The combined locations, World of Progress, Herodotus System, and Conflict Space, are often just referred to as the SLA universe, despite how all three areas are at odds with each other. Practically all the viable planets in the World of Progress serve some function for SLA Industries. So we have the industrial worlds. These are among the most valued planets to SLA Industries. SLA has countless worlds that produce specific consumer items, but industrial worlds tend to have a broader scope. Their duty is spread across a wide range of weapons manufacture, vehicles and armor development, and karma branches of bioengineering. With such densely populated city sprawls, there is always corporate crime and collateral threats. As a result, SLA operatives are always integral to the protection and security of industrial worlds. The largest and most important of all industrial worlds is, of course, Mort itself. Then we have the Lux worlds. These are pleasure planets. They have better standards of living and are by far the least populated planets of the World of Progress. Most wealthy operatives and corporates vacation on deluxe worlds, but they are very expensive to enjoy, even when only staying for a few days or weeks. One of the most famous deluxe worlds is New Paris, which is widely regarded as the most picturesque and well-maintained in the world of progress. But this is the SLA universe, and so there cannot be the sweet without the sour. Intruder has been known to use the beautiful veneer of deluxe worlds to conceal secret black sites away from the prying eyes of head office. These black sites are specially sanctioned torture rooms. When it comes to homeworlds, these are planets for species that have fallen under the banner and protection of SLA. At present, homeworlds are specifically populated by Wraithen, Shaktars, and Ebonites, since these species sided with SLA during the conflict era. Homeworlds usually exist within their kept solar systems and have a capital planet. The Neophron and the far lesser known Omaja are in negotiations to reclaim their homeworlds in SLA space. Let's talk about resource worlds. Resource worlds are SLA's best attempts to maintain viable ecosystems whilst still trying to ravage them for as much as they can withstand. Largely, they are natural environs with little more than exotic flora and fauna populating the surface. SLA Industries usually dots the landscape with a series of scientific outposts in order to study and marginally preserve the environment. Resource worlds are often targeted by contract hunters in search of new exotic animals to capture and sell to the circuit, which will then fight in the arenas. Then we have labor worlds. Much of SLA's primary manufacture takes place on labor worlds, planets dedicated almost entirely to a singular product, armaments being the most common. Labor worlds typically begin life as resource worlds, wherein the planet is selected for its valuable minerals, ore, oil, and flux material, etc. What happened to Mart's no-go zone is what happens on a global scale with labor worlds. The ruthless and excessive mining turns to environmental disaster, beset by storms and hurricanes. Aside from environmental hazards, people in the world of progress fear these places as they can commonly be used as forced labor camps for SLA convicts. Some low-end corporates naively think they can turn a profit on these hellish worlds, but soon find out they are little better off than the broken men and women who suffer and waste away in the enormous factories and mines. Then we have the war worlds. In attempt to subvert global catastrophes, SLA Industries elected to designate certain planets as war worlds. And whilst SLA and its rivals will battle on industrial worlds, most of the greater disputes are started, settled, and started once again on the churned up surface of war worlds like Dante, Cross, and Erebus. Much like labor worlds, they are ravaged over time and gradually transform in purpose when there is little left to utilize and obtain. War worlds tend to devolve from planets who refuse the terms of SLA Industries' three-piece contract. They are deliberately left open to attack and suffer rather unfair consequences. The enemies of SLA take control of these war worlds, and SLA will return with a counterattack. In most cases, this assault is swift and conclusive. SLA wipes away its opponent and installs a franchise infrastructure, converting the planet into a resource or labor world. But the end result, because the planet is frequently contested, still remains as a war world. Then we have franchise worlds. Planets on the brink of collapse often find themselves having to bow down to SLA and become one of the notorious franchise worlds. As part of the franchise initiative, the planet loses its identity and is forced to become a global manufacturing plant for a specific subsidiary of SLA. Fast foods, toy manufacture, vehicles, and tinned goods are the most common. Rarely do world governments willfully enter into these extremely shady, ruthless deals. SLA press gangs the planets into these contracts by pointing out the invading forces threatening to destroy their home, and how their only hope of salvation is to spend the rest of their existence producing burger ingredients, sports footwear, and teddy bears. For most, it is a fate worse than death, as SLA insists a select product or brand be the franchise world's sole focus. People quickly grow sick of the overbearing franchise that permeates every aspect of their lives and careers. Operative squads are often assigned to these worlds when franchise sickness sets in, and hysterical members of the beleaguered public go on homicidal rampages to rid their world of the maddening franchise that obliterated their cultural landscape and social identity. Then we have the backwater worlds. Backwater worlds are the planets positioned on the edges of the world of progress, referred to as the verges. The bank of space that runs dangerously close to the Herodotus system. Backwater worlds tend to become a breeding ground for corporate subversion, and in more extreme cases, a target for the Xi'an cult. As a consequence, threat analysis will send out specially trained spies to infiltrate backwater governments in an effort to spot and report revolution before it can take hold and take the necessary steps to quell an uprising. Next, we have the Herodotus system. At the very edges of the world of progress lies the Herodotus system. Only three planets circle the burning star of Herodotus: Gesmas, Marith, and White Earth. It is widely regarded as the most dangerous and feared system existing within the SLA universe. Its sheer malevolence is felt by all who pass its boundaries. Despite its small size in comparison to the world of progress and conflict space, the Herodotus system is still categorized as a separate territory, as it is governed by neither side of the universe, although there are those that maintain that White Earth's influence rules over conflict space. Now, when it comes to conflict space, this is the lawless and largely unexplored region of space which exists beyond the Herodotus system, believed to be as expansive and densely populated as the world of progress. It is the province of the conflict races, once believed extinct. Those wishing to flee the wrath of SLA often venture into conflict space and take their chances in truly alien and hostile worlds. Many Aethermen journeyed into conflict space for years at a time and returned with wild and elaborate tales. Now let's talk about some details covering space travel. The world of progress spans thousands of star systems, many of which are inhabited and exploited by SLA Industries. Travel amongst these worlds can be achieved by four different systems of transport, although only two of them, reality folding and ion drives, are in common use. First, we have mass drives. SLA Industries used mass drives to get faster than light travel, pushing large ships through space at high speeds to get their personnel and resources to far-off worlds within 2 to 6 months, extending the world of progress at a rate limited only by the time their assets could spend in deep space. Superior ion drive technology is commonly used, but older mass drive ships are occasionally found in use where the cost is a factor and time isn't. But with the increased efficiency of ion drives, they are getting less and less common. Now, when it comes to ion drives, when the Shakhtar joined SLA Industries, they brought with them a superior, faster-than-light system. While these hulking ships are still built by Shakhtars around Kn'th, that's how you pronounce it in their alien language, SLA-built cargo ships using Shakhtar technology have been commonplace for hundreds of years. The ion drive is also used in shuttles that take people and cargo from the surface of planets to the large orbiting ships, and they are also used to get commercial fold ships out of the gravity wells of stars. Once an ion drive ship reaches about 3% of light speed, they create wormholes that act similar to reality folding, only nowhere near as instantaneous, with travel taking around a month. Let's talk about reality folding. Mastery of the ebb allowed short-distance reality folding to evolve into the interplanetary travel, with a few caveats. Gravity and momentum are easy to deal with on a small scale, with basic formulation having enough room for minor errors to be ignored. But on a large interplanetary scale, gravity becomes far too dangerous and complicated to factor in. With commercial flight, this means that a ship would need to use conventional mass drive or ion drive to get out of range of the sun before folding, where the decreased gravitational pull of the sun no longer plays an effect on the formulae calculations. You can get anywhere in the world of progress in 2 weeks, but if you can afford it, you can do it even quicker with a qualified Ebonite pilot, as long as you don't need to keep your lunch down. Now let's talk about cutter engines. The Neofronts came to the world of progress in small ships known as cutters. The cutter engines were smaller than the ion drives used in transport ships and shuttles. Cutter engines are only effective up to a certain mass, but they are considerably quicker than ion drives. Cutters also have gravity dampers that allow faster speeds without discomfort. A neofront cutter can be large enough for a crew of a dozen or so, and can travel anywhere in between 10 and 20 days, using the same wormholes as Shakhtar ships, only spending a lot less time in the non-space. Now, planets typically have spaceports where shuttles take you into orbit, where you transfer to a fault ship or, if you're cargo, an ion drive ship. These transports usually double up as airports on planets with commercial airports. Mort City's spaceport, located inside the perimeter wall in Uptown, is one of the busiest and is not burdened with aircraft as the weather makes flight almost impossible. After all of that, we have details on observation status. The classification of planets in the World of Progress is currently managed by observation status, a recent amalgam of departments coalesced from smaller departments to present a unified catalog of planets. Their standard listings are designed to provide operatives and employees with enough information to quickly decide on off-world VPNs and other excursions. Observation status describes each planet with its name, system, type, output, size, population, and prosperity. Let me tell you a bit about each of these planets. We have Scorch. Scorch, or as its native people call it, Bolarbo, is a small backwater on the verges of the World of Progress. Scorch borders on being classified as a resource world, as it grows a particular form of plant used in the creation of the SLA drug Alice, but its output is currently low. Most of the planet's limited economy is built around the harvesting, partial synthesis, and shipping of the derived chemical. Then we have Gregory IV. To be sentenced to a labor world is a life sentence of hard labor. Gregory IV is one of the worst labor planets in the World of Progress. Prisoners are forced to work 15-hour days with no breaks, followed by 5 hours of sleep. The planet is bitterly cold, and the terrain exclusively tundra, meaning that the ore and rocks are extremely difficult to quarry. Next we have Magra Teal. Dark Moon Shakhtars are either found on the Gate of Herodotus or in their own neighboring Rot system. The Black Jewel in Rot is the industrial world, Magra Teal. The primary function of Magra Teal is the production and repair of ion drive ships. It is also homeworld to the ruling Dark Moon clans. Then we have Ram Dev. With no permanent residence, the planet is covered in flattened geography, with containers and vehicles. Originally used as an offloading point for vehicles built on Zvest, the other planet in the chapter system, other industrial planets switched to using Ramdev as a shipping hub for cars and other vehicles. Next we have Dante. Dante is the most famous and notorious warworld in SLA-owned space. Battles have raged on its surface for centuries, with each oppressor power vying to dominate with a level of rage and hatred only comparable to that seen last in the conflict era. SLA sends the best weapons and technology to Dante to ensure victory over its rivals. In contrast to that, we have New Paris. The favorite holiday destination of SLA's corporate class, the center of culinary excellence, style, art, and wine. New Paris is a planet of one city, and a lot of picturesque agriculture. With a bustling nightlife and busy spaceport to go with relaxed sojourns and fine dining, there's always something to keep you busy and distracted from the looming return flight. If you're tired of New Paris, you're tired of life. We also have Big Smile World. When the Emperor of Belleron signed his world over to SLA Industries, he thought he was signing a protection contract. He wasn't wrong, but unfortunately, he had not considered what the three P's in the three P's contract actually stood for. Belleron also got progress, prospects, and prosperity. The planet has been rebranded and its populace, land, and resources redeployed. The Azure Coast is now the Mustard Coast, the capital city, the Patty Precinct. Each region, or in some cases country, is utilized to produce a specific aspect of the Big Smile menu. Be that pickles, fries, burger buns, or condiments. So this is basically McDonald's planet. Then we have Dal Blair 2. Originally a beautiful planet with a novel and fragile jungle ecosystem, Dal Blair 2 is one of the three planets in the Aira system that had life. each covered in over 80% forests. These trees are over 200 meters tall, with a diameter of approximately 20 meters. The largest planet, Dalblair 1, has been stripped of all resources and is now nothing more than a barren rock. Dalblair 2 will soon follow its fate, having been half stripped of lumber already. And this concludes part 4 of the review. As you can see, life in the world of progress has a strange contrast of being very bleak, difficult, but with some luxuries and advantages at times. But those luxuries seem to be temporary. Once more, you must return to work to slave away under the auspices of SLA Industries. Thanks for watching this part of the review, and thank you so much to those of you that have been supporting the channel by sending drive-through RPG gift certificates. If anyone else wants to further support the channel, the information on how to do that will be in the description below. Once again, thank you, and see you later.